Valley of Tribulations. This is the fourth Valley of Tribulation, is the fourth Valley of Meditation or Sufis. Each one of you is composed of two parts, the conscious and unconscious. The unconscious part of you has again two parts, subconscious and unconscious. All our actions arise out of subconscious or unconscious. How does this arise? When we are doing our actions or doing things, we are not conscious of it. It is guided by the unconscious and subconscious part of our life, which has been already stored. This is the dark night. With Valley of Tribulations, you enter into unconscious part. Up to now, you were confined to the world of the conscious. Now, for the first time, you will enter into the deeper realms of your being. You remember, one part of your being is conscious and nine parts of your being is unconscious. Up to now, you were in the day part. It was easier. Now things will become more difficult. The higher you go, the more you have to pay. With each step, the journey becomes more arduous and fall becomes more dangerous, and one has to be more and more alert. On each step, more awareness will be needed because you will be moving on higher planes. When we do not live our life moment to moment out of consciousness, then all that our actions, thoughts, feelings, etc., they enter into subconscious and unconscious part of our life. If we draw a graph between the x and y axis, the coordinates at the point where x and y axis intersect one another, the x-axis moves to the right of the ordinate and y-axis above of the ordinate. This is called or known as the conscious part. When the y-axis moves below the 0-0 ordinate, that means the value of x-ordinate is x is positive and y is negative. X-axis moves to the left of the ordinate and y-axis moves below the ordinate. Then the value of both x and y ordinate will be negative. This is the part which is known as unconscious and subconscious. As such, where you are at the conscious layer. Below that is subconscious, unconscious, and collective unconscious. Subconscious is your past actions which you are born with, you come with. An unconscious part of your life is incorporates all that actions and thoughts that are performed unconsciously. And what does collective unconscious means? When two unconscious people meet one another, it becomes collective. One man is angry on a certain point, maybe family life, maybe with his wife. You enter into a bar, there you meet another person who has the similar views or had the similar problem, the level of unconsciousness increases. This is a crowd mentality. When there is a riot or anything of that nature, all those people who take part in these kind of activities of looting and all that, that is part of the collective unconscious. On your own, you will not go and thief from a shop. When there is a crowd, mob is stampeding on the streets, destroying the shops, then even if you do not want to steal a watch or two or things on your own, but as a part of the crowd, you will do that. This is the crowd or the mob mentality. This is known as collective unconscious. And during the valley, when you have reached the valley of tribulations, you have to be conscious of all these. And one has to be more and more alert. On each step, more awareness will be needed because you will be moving on the higher planes. The valley of tribulation is the entry into the unconscious. It is the entry into what Christian mystics have called the dark night of the soul. It is the entry into the mad world that you are hiding behind yourself. It is very weird. It is very bizarre. Up to the third, a man can proceed without a master, but not beyond the third. Up to the third, one can go on one's own. With the fourth, a master is a must. And when I am saying that one can go up to the third on one's own, I do not mean that one has to go. And I do not mean that everybody will be able to go on his or her own. I am simply talking of a theoretical possibility. Up to the third, it is theoretically possible that a man can go without a master. But with the fourth, the master becomes an absolute necessity. Because now you will be sinking into darkness. You do not have any light of your own that you can use in the darkness. And this is not an ordinary light, instead it is the light of awareness. Somebody else's light will be needed. Somebody who has gone into that dark night and for whom it has become possible to see in that darkness. The negative part of the valley of tribulation is doubt. Great doubt will arise. You do not know what doubt is. You do not know yet. All that you think is doubt is nothing but skepticism. It is not doubt. Doubt is an altogether different phenomenon. Somebody says God is, you say I doubt. You don't doubt. How can you doubt? You are only being skeptical. You are only saying I don't know. Rather than saying I don't know, you are using a very strong word, doubt. How can you doubt? Doubt is possible when you are facing a reality. For example, you have never seen a ghost and you say I doubt the existence of ghosts. That is not doubt. That is just being skeptical. You are simply saying I have never come across one, so how can I believe? I doubt. That is not doubt. Doubt will be when one day passing through the cemetery, you suddenly come across a ghost. Then your whole being will be shaken. Then you will be for the first time in the state where doubt arises. Whether that which you are facing is true or a hallucination. Doubt is existential. Skepticism is intellectual. Skepticism is only in the mind, and doubt enters into your being, your whole body, mind, soul. Your totality is shaken. In this dark night of soul, doubt arises. Doubt about God, because you were seeking for more light and this is happening just the opposite. You were seeking for more bliss and you have fallen into the dark night. A great doubt arises about whether you are going right, about whether this seeking is worth it, because you were seeking for gold. And you are seeking for great light and great enlightenment and nirvana and samadhi. These dark nights has overwhelmed you. Even those lights that used to be there are there no more. Even those certainties that used to be there are no more. You used to know certain things, now you know nothing. You had some security, even that is gone. The very earth underneath your feet has slipped away, you are drowning. Then doubt arises. Then you start feeling that maybe this whole religious trip is nonsense. Maybe there is no God. Maybe you were fooling yourself. Maybe you have chosen something absurd. It was better to live in the world, to be of the world. It is better to have many more things, to enjoy power, to enjoy sex, to enjoy money. What have I done? I have lost all, and this is the result. To every seeker this moment comes, and if this doubt arises, then naturally one starts defending oneself against the darkness. One creates armor around oneself against the darkness, the invading darkness. One has to protect oneself. If you do that, you will be thrown back again to the conscious part of your mind. You will miss the mystery of darkness. Light is beautiful, but nothing compared with the darkness. Darkness is more profound, more beautiful, more cooling and deeper. Darkness is depth, light is shallow. And unless you are able to welcome darkness, you will never be able to welcome death. So the first thing is that you have to accept, welcome and relax. This darkness is the first glimpse of God. It is dark, but later on you will understand that it was not dark. It was really that for the first time you had opened your eyes towards God, and it was too dazzling. That is why it looked dark. It was not dark. Darkness was your own interpretation. Look at the sun for a few seconds, and soon you will be surrounded by a darkness. It is too much. You cannot bear it. A man can go blind by looking at the sun too long. Look at the sun for a few seconds and then go into the house. You will find the whole house full of darkness. Just a moment before you were there and you could see everything. Now you cannot see anything. You will stumble over things. That it is dark is interpretation, but it is natural. Later on, when you have transcended the valley, then you will be able to look back and see the reality. Only a master can hold your hand in this dark night of the soul, can say to you and convince you, do not be worried. It looks dark. It is not dark. It is the first meeting with God. You are coming closer. There are three things to be understood: sleep, death and samadhi. Sleep is like death. In the East, we say it is the small death, the tiny one. We die each night and disappear into the dark night. Then comes death, a bigger death than sleep. The body disappears, but the mind remains and is born again. Then comes the ultimate death, samadhi, where body disappears, the mind disappears, and only the innermost core, consciousness or room remains. That is the ultimate death. In the fourth valley, you encounter the first glimpse of how the ultimate death is going to happen to you. If you reject it, it will defend. If you reject it, if you defend yourself against it, if you create your armor, you will be thrown back to the third valley and you will miss. And once you have missed the fourth, you will always remain afraid to go again into it. My observation about people is that who have entered into the fourth valley sometimes in their past lives have become too frightened and escaped from it are the people who are always afraid of anything deeper. Love and they will be afraid. Orgasm and they will be afraid. Friendship and only so far. Beyond that they will be afraid. Discipleship and they will be afraid. Surrender and they will be afraid. Prayer, they will be afraid. They will be afraid of all those things that can just bring them to that fourth valley. They may not be consciously aware of why they are afraid. The fourth valley is very important because it is just in the middle. There are seven valleys. The fourth is just in the middle. Three are on this side and three on the other side. Fourth is therefore immensely significant. It is the bridge. The master is needed on this bridge because you pass from known to the unknown, from the finite to the infinite, from the trivial to the profound. The positive part is trust, surrender. The negative part is doubt and defense. The master starts teaching you about trust and surrender from the very beginning so that by and by it becomes your climate because it will be needed when you enter into the fourth valley. Sometimes people come to me and say, why can't we be here without surrendering? Why can't we meditate and listen to you and be benefited as much as we want? What is the point of surrendering? They don't understand. In the beginning, it may look very relevant. Why? For what? You can listen to me without surrendering. And you can meditate here without surrendering. You can pass through growth groups without surrendering. It seems perfectly okay. Surrendering does not seem to be needed at all. But you do not know what is going to happen in the future. For that, preparation has to be made right now. You can wait for that moment. If preparation has not been made before, then you will miss. Then when the right time comes, when your house is on fire and you have not dug the well yet, and you start digging it, by the time it is ready, the house will be gone. One has to dig the well before the house catches the fire. So right now it may seem relevant. I can understand. Logically, it is not relevant right now. Listening to me what surrender is needed. Meditating what surrender is needed. But when you enter the fourth valley, surrender will be needed. And you cannot suddenly learn the ways of surrender. You have to go on learning them from before the need arises. Surrender has to become your climate to cross over this bridge of the fourth valley, the valley of tribulations.